HarperCollins presents Becoming Forrest, one man's epic run across America, written and read by Rob Pope. To my mum, Nadine and Bea, you made the difference. Becoming Forrest, one man's epic run across America, by Rob Pope. Leg 1, 15th of September to 30th of November 2016. Alabama, Mississippi, Louisiana, Texas, New Mexico, Arizona, and California. That's 2,259.45 miles. Chapter 1. Time to roll. Tide. Alabama. Days 1 to 3. 49.04 miles. Roadkill count, 7. 3 armadillos, 2 possums, and 2 raccoons. Chased by a dog count, 1. Chihuahua. Inquiries after my sanity, 1. And encounters with potentially life-threatening spiders, 1. What would you like? The barber asked. I've always found it a strangely intimidating question. Today even more so. I'd been waiting an hour before sitting in his chair and had watched him meticulously groom a procession of locals with clippers and a flashing cutthroat. Tentatively, I produced a photo of Tom Hanks. Or more to the point, a photo of his hairdo from the film Forrest Gump. To help, I also quoted a number at him from the menu of styles pinned to the door. Like number 24, please. He looked at me with a raised eyebrow. You want a high-end type? Yeah. Yes, please. Are you kidding me, man? It seemed only polite to explain why a veterinarian from Liverpool had travelled all the way to Fluke's Barbers on North Broad Street in Mobile, Alabama, on the morning of Thursday, the 15th of September, 2016. Before my journey was through, I'd get very used to telling this story. I'm recreating the Forrest Gump run. From the movie? Yeah, I'm going to run from here to Santa Monica in California. Forrest made 5 crossings in total, and someone's calculated that this was a distance of 15,248 miles, all told, apparently. For no particular reason. A number of athletes had already made a single crossing, but as far as I knew, nobody had ever done 5. People had written articles about whether it was even possible. I wasn't sure, but I wanted to be the guy who tried. That said, I only mentioned the possibility of doing 5 crossings to one person. My girlfriend Nadine, aka Nads. That much running seemed like a pipe dream, so the official version was that I'd try one crossing and take it from there. The barber was incredulous, even about one crossing. That's a long way. He couldn't suppress his grin. You've done this kind of thing before? I shrugged. Not exactly. A few marathons and one ultramarathon. He nodded. And how far have you got? I was bursting with excitement. This is day 1. A local news station is filming the start, so I wanted to look the part. Well, good luck to you, man, he said, chuckling to himself as the first locks drifted to the floor, while everyone in the shop cast sideways glances. 40 minutes later, I was fit for the US Marine Corps, in looks at least, and I spent the next few hours enjoying the novelty of touching the back of my newly shorn head and my face. Several blocks away, the WKRG local news team were waiting for me. It was time to begin. I've always had a vivid imagination. Maybe it's the lot of a single child, or maybe it's just the way my brain works. But I always knew it might get me into trouble someday. I got into running at an early age. I was already a marathon veteran by the time I got my PhD in veterinary medicine in 2010. I relocated to Melbourne, Australia, where I came 10th overall in the IAAF gold-rated 2015 Sydney Marathon, which qualified me for the Rio Olympics and made me Australian champion to boot. For various reasons, which centred around my not really being fast enough, I wouldn't go to Rio. But a year later, everything in my life fell into place for me to fly to the US to attempt the impossible. So, of all the running stories I might have chosen to emulate, why Forrest Gump's? Well, if you're a runner who's had the pleasure of passing a gang of youths or a bar, especially if you've got long hair and, God forbid, a beard, I'd be willing to bet you've heard the shouts of, "Run, Forrest, run!" His assimilation into the perception of the world of running, despite his distinguished military career and stint as a top-level ping-pong player, is so complete that anyone who undertakes a challenge more than a few marathons long seems to be labelled as the, insert adjective or nationality here, Forrest Gump. I was 38 when I started, the same age as Tom Hanks when he filmed the movie. And while that's not young for an athlete, it's not a terrible age to attempt a long-distance run. And America had always represented magic and excitement to me. It was a country of music and film legends, of stories and adventure. Whether it was Bob Dylan, Bruce Springsteen, or even a non-American singing about a place where the streets were nameless, I'd been inspired to dream of running through the Nevada desert, the Joshua Tree National Park, and Chicago, across the Mississippi, past Atlantic Records, Graceland, and the Big Rock Candy Mountain. I spent endless hours poring over previous crossings and possible routes, studying the weather in different states at different times of the year, wondering whether I could actually hack it. Forrest says in the movie that he ran for 3 years, 2 months, 14 days, and 16 hours. Many commentators have argued that his achievement was not physically possible, that the human body could simply not withstand the daily grind of running such distances for so long. Then one day, I came across a book by a British chap named Nick Baldock, who had run from San Francisco to New York in 1999. He described the epic scale and beauty of the country in a way that utterly captivated me. I was hooked. I emailed him 10 years after his feat, in May 2009, with the subject field, Forrest Gump 2, and he replied with some advice. Funding was, apart from the running itself, the single biggest challenge. I gave myself a good 12 to 14 months to prepare, both financially and fitness-wise. You, no doubt, are younger and fitter, so that may not be the case with you. Rob, it is a wonderful thing to do. I could never tell you just how hard it was, but equally, it was truly a life-changing experience for 132 days for me. The best way to see America. Duly inspired, but duly warned. Nadine and I worked our butts off in the veterinary surgery, pooling together enough savings to keep us going for as long as possible. In terms of the physical preparation, I knew I was a half-decent runner, but this was the complete unknown. I couldn't even call myself a true ultra-runner, the title reserved for those who had gone beyond the marathon distance. But a couple of months before I was due to depart for the Forest Run, I entered the Runstock Ultra with a friend from Australia, Flynn Hargreaves. I clocked up 75 kilometres, or 47 miles in old money, and while it wasn't exactly a breeze, it did feel doable. I ran for the WWF, the Worldwide Fund for Nature, in that event. As a keen animal lover, the WWF have always had a place in my heart, and I decided to fundraise for them during the Forrest Gump Run too. I'd also be running for Peace Direct, a charity dedicated to stopping war and building lasting peace in some of the world's most fragile countries. And if these organisations weren't enough, there was one other source of inspiration for me. Perhaps the most important and fundamental of all. My momma, as Forrest would say. My mum, Kathy Pope, was a medical laboratory scientific officer and a hard-working single mother. She was my rock and my best friend. She was only too pleased I had also chosen a scientific career. And as a passionate supporter of my running, she took me to my races and marathons, and even to the 1997 New York Marathon. She was diagnosed with cancer, but that didn't stop her enrolling at university to study law. And she was top of her class before she became too ill to continue. If I'd inherited even a fraction of her grit, I knew I'd be okay. While she was sick, she'd made me promise one thing to her. Do one thing in your life that makes a difference. That promise has stuck with me since then. It's become a part of everything I hope to achieve. She passed away in 2002. She's my inspiration, my frustration, my warrior queen, my support crew leader. I still miss her now. And so, for these particular reasons, on Thursday the 15th of September, I stepped out of Fluke's Barbers and decided to go for a little run. Gump movie fans will of course know that he's from Greenbow, Alabama, where he was raised dutifully by his mama, and where he would meet Jenny, the love of his life. From there, he'd take the first steps on what turned out to be a remarkable journey. The problem was, the Greenbow does not exist and never has. The Gump family home was even built especially for the film and no longer stands in its South Carolina location, so I couldn't even bend the narrative and start from there. The book on which the film was based, however, was by Mobile native Winston Groom, and so it came to pass the Forrests, and therefore my story, began there too. I was in full Gump paraphernalia. Chinos, check shirt, a pristine new pair of white Nike Cortez, and sitting in a chair out front of the Bragg Mitchell Mansion, a grand Greek Revival plantation house on the outskirts of the city, and the closest thing I could find to the now raised Gump boarding house in the district. I put on my red Bubba Gump Shrimp Company cap, rose slowly, and broke into a walk, then a jog, then a run. I ran to the end of the road, and when I got there, I thought I'd maybe run to the edge of town. On reaching a fork in the road, I decided to go right rather than left and got a bit lost. It wouldn't be my first wrong turn. Hot, humid night had fallen like a stone over the Mobile skyline, and I was running blind. I headed over to the parking lot of a Family Dollar store and tapped on the window of a lady sitting in her car. She lowered the window around half an inch, looking completely petrified behind the glass, but she thankfully pointed me in the right direction. Of course, I was yet to adjust to the life of a guy who just eats, runs and sleeps, so when I finally caught up with her, Nadine was hugely relieved to see me again. She'd been on the verge of filing a missing persons report with the police. We went out to a little place called the OK Bicycle Shop, where no bicycles were available for sale or rent, but the beer was good. And the proprietors, Jim and Woody, bought into the idea of the run. They promised me they'd get in touch with Winston Groom. May sadly now rest in peace, and I told them I'd be back as soon as I headed out the door, unsteadily enough to suggest I'd run a lot further than the 5 miles I'd covered that evening. As is the way of many a barroom conversation, neither of these things ever happened. But we were all richer for the thought. We indulged in a comfortable night in the Malaga Inn, a last little touch of luxury that I felt Nadine deserved after the previous few days in America, getting ready for this and the months of turmoil before. We weren't going to be able to get into a proper rhythm until we had the RV, which we were picking up in Houston, Texas. So in the meantime, we were making do with motels and car hire. I lay in bed, staring at the ceiling, listening to the distant sounds of the city winding down. I was convincing myself that it would all be fine, and that we'd get to Bayou La Batterie, a marathon or so from downtown Mobile, by the close of play the next day. Waking up in the morning, it felt like the real deal.
I'd woken up. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.